Hallelujah and blessings in Jesus, friends. Welcome back to Hayekadosh Ministries, where holiness is truly a way of life. Jesus is King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and the Holy Bible is our only standard and authority for truth. And together God's people say, Hallelujah. Hallelujah to the Lamb of Glory. Well, friends, we are continuing our study on the road to Calvary. Now, we have been experiencing some computer issues over the last month. Matter of fact, I had to send it back to the manufacturer. So I apologize for the lengthy delay in getting this second video out in this series. But hopefully all is behind us and we should be able to move forward with no setbacks. Now today we're going to look at chapter 3 and chapter 4. And chapter 3 is titled The Holy Spirit, the Advocate of the Lord Jesus. Chapter 4 is The Holy Spirit, the Convictor. Now, if you've been with us in Book 1 and Book 2, I'm sure that your life is being changed in many ways as you conform yourself to these simple truths and you allow the work of the Holy Spirit to change you and to cleanse you from the inside. You see, so often we focus on the outside, but it is the inside that Jesus came to change. And once the inside is changed, then the outside will follow suit. So let's begin with chapter 3, again entitled The Holy Spirit, the Advocate of the Lord Jesus. Now we may now turn to consider what is the function or work of the Holy Spirit here on earth. The Lord Jesus referred to him, the Holy Spirit, on a number of occasions as the Comforter. We see this in John chapter 14, verse 16, again in verse 26, and chapter 15, verse 26. And he told the disciples that it was expedient, it was necessary that he, the Lord Jesus, should go away. For if he did not go away, the Comforter would not come unto them. We see this in John chapter 16, verse 7. Now this word Comforter will help us to understand the function of the Holy Spirit among us. It is the same word in the Greek, which is paraclete, as appears in 1 John 2:1, when it is translated advocate. It says in 1 John 2:1, if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he is the propitiation for our sins. Therefore, it would be quite in order to substitute the word advocate for the word comforter with regard to the Holy Spirit. This means there are two advocates referred to in these passages. The one is the Lord Jesus Christ, and the other is the Holy Spirit. An advocate is, as we know, one who looks after our interest in a court of law, and he answers for us. Here we have a picture of the word of the Lord Jesus for us. He is our advocate in heaven, and as such, he delights to look after the repentant sinner's interest in those awesome courts. He does not attempt to produce evidence to show our innocence. He knows that every accusation of the holy law of God against us is true, but he pleads on our behalf the value of his atoning blood. When we sin, our advocate presents himself to the Father as the propitiation for our sins. As the old hymn says, he shows his wounds and spreads his hands. But for the heavenly intercession of his advocate, every child of God would have lost his relationship with the Father long ago. However, he does lose his sense of peace with God when he sins. But as he confesses his sin, he has a renewal of that peace with God through the blood of Jesus, which he knew when he first came to him. How wonderful to have a friend at court like this. Now in this passage in John, however, the Holy Spirit is also called an advocate. This advocate is not resident in heaven, but he is in the hearts of believers with whom he comes to dwell when they are born again. But whose advocate is he? not the believer's advocate, but rather the Savior's, whose interest he is charged to safeguard. Here then are the two advocates, the believer's advocate with the Father, which is Jesus, and Christ's advocate with the believer, which is the Holy Spirit. The one looks after the believer's interest in heaven. The other looks after Christ's interest in the believer on earth. Now this makes quite clear his great function. It is to safeguard the interest and throne rights of the Lord Jesus in the world in which we live, the church, and the individual believer. This is precisely what the Lord Jesus meant when he said of the Holy Spirit, "He shall glorify me." We see this in John chapter 16, verse 14. You see, his work is to represent Christ, to speak of Christ, to exalt Christ, to deal with men with regard to Christ, to convict them of sin because they have not believed on Christ, to cause them to repent because of the place they have not given to Christ. Christ, Christ, Christ is the theme of all his speech and the direction of all his activity. But the Lord not only said of him, "He shall glorify me," but he also said, "He shall receive of mine and shall show it unto you." John 16, 14. This simply means surely that having brought us to repentance with regard to Christ, he will show us the resources of Christ to deal with our now acknowledged sinfulness. Spirit of God, my teacher be, showing the things of Christ to me. And these things mentioned here are the things concerning his grace for the guilty, his love for the unlovely, the completeness of his redemption, and the value of his blood and righteousness for people as bad as we now acknowledge ourselves to be. Indeed, the sufficiency of Jesus for every possible need. They are the things that make for the sinner's peace and pardon, for the Lord Jesus came into the world to save such. It is quite obviously the work of his advocate to show to penitent ones the complete adequacy of his resources to that end. Indeed, nowhere does the Spirit so glorify Christ as when he reveals the riches of his grace for failures who acknowledge their failure. The recovery of human failure is the sphere where Jesus Christ excels. That's where he gets his name. He is not shocked by sin, nor is he defeated by it, for this is the realm where grace finds its opportunity, and he has the answer for it. The convicted one would never believe it, did not the Holy Spirit reveal it to him. How glorious does the Savior become in his eyes under the Spirit's ministry? Here then is the Holy Spirit as the great advocate of the Lord Jesus, to make known to us our need and the rich provisions in Jesus to meet those needs. Well has A.H. Vine put it in this hymn to the Holy Spirit, "Christ is our advocate on high. Thou art our advocate within. O plead the truth and make reply to every argument of sin." It might be, however, better to say that the Holy Spirit is not our advocate, but Christ's advocate, for it is as such that he pleads the truth and makes reply to every argument of sin, pointing to Christ and his blood as the answer, the only answer. A vivid illustration of the position and work of the Holy Spirit in God's dealings with men is contained in the story of Abraham sending his servant to a distant land to seek a bride for his son Isaac. If that servant had spoken of himself and fixed men's eyes there, he would have failed his objective. However, having found the right girl, his real work was only just begun. it was so to speak of his master's son as to draw her heart to that son and make her willing to break with her family and follow him back to Isaac. Morning, noon, and night, there was but one theme to his conversation: my master's son. His appearance and attractiveness were doubtless enlarged upon, but especially his wealth. For he said about him, unto him hath my master given all that he hath. The earrings and bracelets with which he had decked her with, but specimens of the wealth that would be the girl's who consented to become his wife. He was apparently a highly eligible young man. Now when Laban saw the earrings and bracelets upon his sister's hands, he said quickly, come in, thou blessed of the Lord. Wherefore standest thou without? Come in, he said in effect, and tell us more about your master's son. And so he was given ample scope to exercise his ministry. In no time at all, the girl's heart was won, and she gave her answer, I will go. The servant's joy was fulfilled when at last he saw Rebekah in Isaac's arms. The work of the blessed Holy Spirit is precisely to play the part with us that Abraham's servant played with them long ago. It is to speak of Christ and of grace and of glory as to woo and win our hearts and make us willing to follow him to Calvary, there to take the sinner's place at the feet of Jesus. And he does this not only to bring about our first meeting with Jesus, but continually ever after, whenever sin has made us cold and dry and barren. How good it is that Jesus has not left himself without an advocate on earth to represent himself in our hearts and to draw us back again and again to his cross, the place of release and victory. The Holy Spirit, then, has but one purpose, and that is to exalt Christ. A grasp and experience of this fundamental fact will save us from all sorts of mistakes and sometimes from being dangerously sidetracked. If an outstanding experience of the Holy Spirit leads us to exalt the Holy Spirit and to center on that experience, then we will find that instead of cooperating with the Holy Spirit, we are actually thwarting him in his design to direct man's eyes on the Lord Jesus alone. In other words, if our focus is upon the Holy Spirit and what he has done or is doing, then we are wrong in our considerations. It is only when our focus is upon Jesus Christ that we gather the blessing from the Lord Jesus Christ, because the work of the Holy Spirit is to point to Jesus Christ in all things and at all times. Part 4, the Holy Spirit as the convictor. For simplicity's sake, we can divide the Holy Spirit's work as the advocate of the Lord Jesus into two parts. First of all, he comes to reprove or convict us of sin and bring us to repentance. Jesus said, when he is come, he will reprove the world of sin, because they do not believe on me. John chapter 16, verses 8 and 9. Three times in the well-known chapters in John on the Holy Spirit, chapters 14, 15, and 16, he is called by the Lord Jesus the Spirit of Truth. Truth here does not mean a body of doctrine, but the revelation of facts as they really are. This means that it is the work of the Holy Spirit to reveal to us the truth about ourselves as sinners. Silently and inexorably, he is shining the white light of truth all the time on the thoughts and reactions of our hearts, the words of our lips, and the deeds of our hands. Everything which is of self-centeredness and sin is revealed as such, no matter how we dress it up and rationalize it. He is concerned to shatter the realm of illusion about ourselves in which we have been living and bring us to true self-knowledge. His great concern is that we should know the truth, for He is the Spirit of truth. The response, the only response He requires, is simply the response of honesty, which says, "Truth, Lord." To all He shows us about ourselves, without self-excuse or hiding anything. This is what is meant by, "Thou desirest truth in the inward parts." We read that in Psalm chapter 51. The same phrase, "Thou desirest," comes a little further down the same psalm, only this time it is, "Thou desirest not sacrifice." Now put these two together, and you discover the message of that psalm. "Thou desirest not sacrifice, but truth in the inward parts." So often activity, even Christian service, can be a cloak to hide the truth both from ourselves and from others. The Holy Spirit is against all such self-deception and sham. It is truth and not sacrifice which He requires in such a case. This is what is meant too by the phrase, "doeth truth," in John 3:21. There we read that whereas he that does evil hates the light, neither comes to the light, lest his deeds should be reproved. It is he that does truth who comes to the light, that his deeds may be made manifest that are wrought in God. We would have thought that the opposite of doing evil would be doing good, but not with God. With Him, the opposite of doing evil is doing truth. That is honesty about our evil, honesty about ourselves, absolute transparency within our hearts. Before we ever try to do good where we have done evil, He wants a full exposure to Him of that evil, a simple saying of, "Truth, Lord," to what He is showing us. He would much rather have us turn back the past leaves than turn over a new leaf. For when we turn over a new leaf, we of necessity hide the former leaf. And when sin is hidden, the blood of Jesus cannot cleanse us, nor we ourselves be brought to peace. The promise of forgiveness and cleansing is conditioned on simply confessing our sins. 1 John 1:9. We do not have to ask for forgiveness if we have confessed our sins. We get it on the spot, the moment that we confess. But all the asking in the world will not bring peace to our hearts if there is a reservation in our confession. This is so not only between man and God, but it is also seen to be ineffectual between man and fellow man. Who of us have not found ourselves saying to another in our attempt to get right with him something like, "Please forgive me if I have wronged you," and wondered why it did nothing to heal the breach? There is no if. Let us confess we have wronged him, and we may be surprised at the speed at which the grace of God reaches us, and very often the forgiveness of man too. So rather than say, "Please forgive me if I have wronged you," we should simply say, "Please forgive me, I have wronged you." This then is the conviction of the Holy Spirit, the shining of the light of truth, and the response of truth which is required of us. And this shining of the light of truth is going on all the time, as silently and as inexorably as the shining of the sun. It is surely inconceivable that the Holy Spirit only convicts of sin at special seasons of spiritual awakening, and is content to let us off at other times. There is no out-of-season time for the Holy Spirit. He is continually, moment by moment, convicting us of the sin that lies within our hearts. if we have not been conscious of that conviction of sin, it is not because he has not been convicting, but rather because we have not been willing to hear and to see. It is easy to avoid conviction of sin, for the Spirit's voice is gentle. Only those who are eager to be convicted will hear his voice, and they only will be eager because they hunger for the Lord Jesus and know that this is the only way by which they will be freed from the things that separate them from him, whom they have begun to love. Sometimes we are in a condition where no conviction seems to come to us, and we think all must be well. Then we might meet some other Christians who are praising God with a fresh testimony of how the Spirit has convicted them on some particular point, and the blood of Jesus has cleansed them at that point. We look on at them with wonder, feeling that this is not our experience. Is it that we have got beyond the need of being dealt with about such things? Or is it that we are just not seeing them as they are? So often, friends, it is the latter. And the reason why we are not seeing these, what we may call smaller things, is that there is some larger, more basic matter we are not willing for God to deal with. Let us imagine, to illustrate, a high wall which casts a strong shadow in the bright sunlight. In that shadow, the many weeds growing there are hardly noticed. But when that large wall is removed, the light then shows up and exposes the smaller weeds, each one casting its own shadow, and then they can be removed. To walk in the light with God, as we are told in 1 John 1:7, simply means to say yes to what that light reveals. This may mean the removing of some very real barriers between us and God. And notice, these are not large, mighty oak trees. These are small, tiny weeds. And it is these small, tiny things we must focus upon in our lives. But that may not lead to less conviction of sin, but rather more. For now the Lord can show us the smaller day-to-day things that spring up so easily from our fallen natures. But conviction is always followed by cleansing, if we are quick to say, "Yes, Lord, truth, Lord." Notice, however, that in the work of conviction, the Holy Spirit is all the time acting as the advocate of the Lord Jesus, which means that He, the Holy Spirit, always speaks to us of our sin in relation to Jesus. He does not convict us of sin as something merely unethical or contrary to the Ten Commandments, but as that which has dethroned the Lord Jesus and caused his death upon the cross. The Spirit is not content till we have been helped to look upon Jesus, whom we have pierced, and to mourn for him. Indeed, the nature of sin of which he convicts us is described as of sin because they believe not on me. This suggests that the larger, all-inclusive sin is unbelief, the unwillingness to avail ourselves of the redemption of Christ, and that, in turn, is because of our stiff-necked obstinacy and hardness of heart. The Holy Spirit has not been dealing with us very long over something before the issue shifts from the sin in question to the unbroken attitude. The obstinacy and the self-justification we manifest over his dealings. What an illustration we have of the Spirit's conviction and our unwillingness in the story of the servants of Naaman pleading with their master when he was unwilling to obey the prophet's words to go and wash in Jordan 7 times. He was willing for anything but that. That would have meant stripping and the extent of his leprosy being seen. But his servants came and pleaded with him so tenderly, for they loved him much, when they said, "My father, if the prophet had bid thee do some great thing, wouldest thou not have done it? How much rather when he saith to thee, wash and be clean. You'll find this story in 2 Kings chapter 5. How glad he was that he yielded to their gentle entreaties. For the moment that he washed in the Jordan, his flesh came again like the flesh of a little child. Even so, the Holy Spirit holds us gently to the one thing we do not want to do because of our pride. Go and wash at the foot of the cross of Christ. You see, we fear the stripping that repentance involves us in, that we shall be seen for what we really are. But how glad we are when we do yield, for we emerge cleansed and made whole through the blood of Christ. It is clear then that in the Spirit's contending with us, he is acting all the time as the advocate of the Lord Jesus, only desiring that we should bow our heads to him and acknowledge him as King of Kings on this new point that is at issue within us. And that brings us to the end of part 3 and 4 and to the end of our video today, friends. And I hope that you are beginning to see that the focus is upon the inner man, not the outer man. It is so important and critical for us to focus upon the tiny issues that lie dormant within our hearts, that go unconfessed, unresolved, and unnoticed, rather than the outward things, the many outward things that we can place our focus upon. For the message is clear, friends. What is the outward is simply religion, legality. But when the focus is placed upon the inward, we now become the true servants, followers, and examples of the Lord Jesus, the way that he lived his life upon this earth, and the way he offers us to live our lives as well. Well, I pray, friends, that you are truly being blessed through this study and that you are being conformed from the inside out. Now, may the Lord Jesus bless you and keep you as you continue to seek what it means to call yourselves a follower of his. Now, as he wills, and until next time, friends, I love you, and I'll see you on the next video.